Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit. Bandwidth for Triangulation is brought to you by Cashfly at cachefly.com. This is Triangulation, episode 164, recorded July 19th for air Monday, August 18th, 2014. Ted Nelson. Triangulation is brought to you by Personal Capital. With Personal Capital, you'll finally have all your financial life in one place and get a clear view of everything you own. Best of all, it's free. To sign up, go to personalcapital.com/triangulation.
Welcome to Triangulation, the show where we bring some of the most interesting people in the world on and talk to them. Ted Nelson is really a legend, a legendary fellow. He's still in his houseboat in Sausalito, California. He joins us now via Skype to talk about Xanadu, which in 1995, Wired magazine called the longest-running vaporware project of all time. I take it you didn't...
Which shows that they know nothing about computer history. I can give you a list of 10 vaporware projects that are far more expensive and long-running.
I think you're right. And in fact, as time's gone by, there's even more now.
Yeah, of course.
Ted, welcome to Triangulation. I'm thrilled to have you on. Thank you for joining
us. We absorbed no more than 200 man-years and no more than $5 million. That's chump change.
Nothing.
Yeah.
So let's start back in the early 60s when you first created this concept of hypertext. Tell me a little bit about the background and where it came from and what you were trying to accomplish.
I was a media guy. When I entered college, I'd already been an actor on stage and TV due to my father. And I had already, in college, I wrote a number of plays. I believe I wrote the first rock musical, though everybody wants to contest that. I had my own magazine. I did this half-hour movie comedy as my first film. And I published my first book and produced a long playing record. So I was very much into media of all kinds. And to me, all media are alike. You think about the effects you want, and you think about what are the technicalities it will take to give you those effects. So when I took a computer course in graduate school, I said, holy smoke, you can put interactive screens on them. Now, for some reason, this was interactive screens were instantly obvious to me. As soon as I saw a picture of a guy sitting at a screen with a light pen, I got the whole picture. And it took other people a long time, but I was a media guy. I said, screens, I can do that. So all media are alike. You figure out what effects you want, and then you figure out what technicalities are required to bring about those effects, and that's what I've been doing ever since.
I think the disadvantage the computer people had at that time was that they were very keenly aware of the limitations of the existing hardware, and they couldn't think out of the box at what might be possible. You were way ahead of your time, really.
Well, in some ways, but Moore's law had already been stated as Moore hadn't stated it, but everybody knew that this was what was happening. And even though cathode ray tubes, interactive displays, were only being used by Cheyenne Mountain nuclear defense and
hackers at MIT,
and air traffic control, those were the two serious issues at the time. The fact that the price was going to come down, everybody would have them, and so I immediately said, "Okay, we're going to have a new world of publishing. People would be able to publish from screen to screen across the world without" any publishing companies in between. Having published my own books, I come from a line of self-publishers. My grandmother published her own books. My great-grandfather published his book. So self-publishing was to me the desired aspect, because publishers, you see, get in the way with their conventional and stereotype notions. If you want to say something original, you have to publish it yourself. So making the world safe for self-publishers on a broad scale was one of the things I was thinking of. But then the issue of the structure of text. Now, I'd always been frustrated by sequential writing. Why does writing have to be in a sequence? Because paper is in a sequence, because we number pages. Why do we number pages? Because they're horizontal, they're rectangular, and they're packed in a sheet after sheet. But if we have screens, they don't have to be packed sheet after sheet. Go to the side, we can go to the top, we can jump to another thing, and there need to be no space limitations. It puzzles me that Wikipedia still makes the length of an article based upon the importance that the subject has in the eyes of the editors. And I say editors, Wikipedia is a benign fraud. You don't edit Wikipedia. You submit changes to the hidden editor. But in any case, figuring out what the new media of the screen would be, that to me was the highest calling I could think of. Still is. Unfortunately, I did not know. I was not very diplomatic. I've always had trouble talking to people who I didn't think were very bright, or people who I thought were too conventional, which was most people. And so it was hard for me to put across these rather radical ideas to people I didn't respect. And so, but I did respect the computer scientists I gave lectures before, and they respected me for a while, until Wired anyway. And so it's been a long political struggle. And I'm not a programmer. I'm a producer-director of software, like Doug Engelbart and like Steve Jobs, which is a very tough road to hoe, because that means you have to persuade and explain and persuade and explain and persuade and explain. So the ideal is to be able to program it yourself, but there's so many levels and so many protocols and so many technicalities, that's certainly impossible for a guy like me.
Do you think this Gary Wolf article in Wired in 95 was damaging to you?
I think it lost 15 years of my life.
Wow.
It was extremely vicious. His undercurrent of hatred is visible and is palpable in every sentence. Every sentence is in a derogatory tone. And there's the lie that begins in this first sentence where he says it was a scary ride to lunch. We have a witness who was in the car who said it was perfectly ordinary drive to lunch. But the point is, at every point, he wants the reader to hate me. And apparently he was very successful in it. Because Wired was giving, these were people I thought were my friends, Jane Metcalf and Louis Rossetto.
Yeah. I mean, if anybody would get the vision, you'd think it'd be Jane and Louis.
Well, I consider it a stab in the back of heroic proportions. Who was the major domo of the Emperor of Rome who murdered his family? Sejanus. I consider it on that scale of a personal betrayal.
Wow, that's sad, because I think everything you've said up to this point is inspiring and exciting, and it's pretty clear that you, earlier than almost anybody, understood what is happening today, what technology has brought us today. In 1974, you wrote a book I remember very well called Computer Lib,
Yep. Subtitled
You Can and Must Understand Computers Now. This 1974, this is before the Apple, this is before the Altair, this is very early days.
Well, interestingly, 3 months ago, they held a party for my work at Chapman University, and the unannounced speaker was Steve Wozniak, who said that basically Computer Lib inspired him to build the Apple II. Just a couple of weeks ago, Bill Gates gave a commencement address at Stanford where he said Computer Lib, he said that Computer Lib was on their minds when they started Microsoft. So yeah, but what I did in that book, I aggregated all the different threads of exciting stuff that was going to happen in the computer world, and nobody in the individual fields was aware of the other ones because, of course, they were all tied up in what they were doing. Right. Whereas I was trying to get a picture of the whole and managed to put it across, and this was found very inspiring by some people. The purpose of the book, however, was to make me financially independent so I could work on my own stuff, and it did not, because I was cheated by many distributors, as so often happens in the art world, and so it's been a tough road to hoe.
It's really quite a beautiful book. It got republished, didn't it? Is it still in print?
It's just come out again. We published it from the negatives. It's very hard to publish from negatives now, because everything's from PDFs, and doing from a PDF would really lose the resolution. So I actually found a printer who could do it. So when I saw it was $300 on eBay, I said, okay, well, we can sell it for $100 and break even.
Awesome. I'm going to order it. Where can I order it?
Hyperland.com.
Can I get you to autograph it?
That's...
You're kind of too busy, huh?
Just handled by somebody else.
Damn it. Maybe I'll come down to the houseboat and I'll knock on your door. So let's go back and say, so you had this, you saw this coming. You clearly saw that. I mean, in 1974, to say there's going to be something called a microcomputer was...
I never used the word ever in my life. the term microcomputer is extremely stupid. Because you, if you have a telephone that can, that's made with circuit chips, does that make it a micro telephone?
No, of course not.
It's still a telephone.
Yes.
A computer that's made with microcircuits is still a computer. And to call it a microcomputer was just it's demeaning. Demeaning and misleading, because it suggests a difference where there is none.
No, in fact, our so-called nobody calls them microcomputers today. That's what they were called. In distinction to mainframes and mini computers, they were microcomputers. But no, but they're more powerful than the mainframes were, so there's nothing micro about them anymore. Even our phones are more powerful than the mainframes were.
Yeah.
So you knew this was coming.
It was obvious. How could you not say it was obvious?
Yeah.
It was just obvious to some people sooner. The way a lot of things are obvious to some people. So.
And because of your background in media, you particularly were interested in how content could be created for this new medium.
And the representation of thought and history and my notion of education, which is different from what people usually mean by education. I want to see education use the natural initiatives and intellectual excitement that's there for everybody to use, whereas when people say, is this useful for education, they mean, is it useful for the existing system of schools, which are essentially a system of dumbing down people's minds, as far as I can see.
Well, there's a whole lot of places we could go, because education is a big one. I love it. But let's stick a little bit with hypertext right now. Don't we have, this is a softball question, don't we have what you envisioned now, thanks to the World Wide Web?
We are misled by the term hypertext. I coined it to mean non-sequential documents. Well, the Xanadu is not hypertext in this trivial sense. Jump links were the first part of Xanadu, but then parallel pages visibly connected was another part. Being able to see the original context of every quotation was another part. Automatic payment system for authors was another part. And so when you say we already have this, we mean we have what other people call hypertext. It has very little relation to what I've done. And the point is that you can't do Xanadu properly with HTML. The job we've done on it, which you can now see at Xanadu.com, is a clumsy simplification, but it's real. So it's a start.
You founded Xanadu in 1960. What took it so long?
We came so close on about three occasions. There have been about 15 different iterations, 15 different designs, but all of them have the same fundamental structure, which means that a document is distributed as a list of parts to put together. So it's an indirect document. All documents are indirect, which has many, many ramifications. And then how they all used links were different. But the first one was in 1972, and we came close to having an early word processor competing at that time with the Wang. But the backer pulled out to save $5,000, and so we lost millions. That was in 1972. The other big one was in 1988, where we got a big bunch of money from Autodesk. And unfortunately, Roger Gregory, who was in charge, lost his position, and the inmates took over the asylum, and the programmers tried to redesign the whole thing and spent millions of dollars over 4 years, and it was canceled by Autodesk, rightly so.
How important, though, is an implementation? Surely your conception should inform others' implementations as well. I mean, why do you need to do an implementation of it?
It doesn't work that way. Everybody has their own idea.
Yeah.
Their own impression. And I'm sorry, the real thing is the real thing, and now that you can see the real thing, you can see what it means for pages to be visible with parallel connections.
Right.
And mapping this to existing structures is existing available mechanisms is one of the hardest parts. And mapping and remaining at the same time loyal to the fundamental concept, because the design we had in 1979 was far superior, and I still want to bring that back. So that the new version has been made compatible with the 1979 version, which Roger Gregory is still working on.
Humans seem to like linearity. I mean, the book is a great success, because we like going from beginning to end, crossing through the middle, and I guess footnotes are one way of kind of glossing a linear text. Just because we have the ability to do it non-linearly with new technology, does it mean we should? Why is that better?
All I can say, this is the medium that I want to write in.
Right.
I have been very frustrated because the things I want to write, no longer to be called books, require parallel pages visibly connected.
That's how your mind works.
I think that's how a lot of people's minds work, but they don't know it until they see it.
Right. It's not storytelling. I mean, we've seen some failed attempts to make storytelling non-linear, where you choose the forks in the road and so forth, and that's kind of frustrating.
Well, I don't know if they're failed or not. They're not a major genre.
Right.
I like them.
Do you like them?
I don't bother with them, but I mean, I don't read fiction either. I don't have time.
Yeah, because fiction really is, I mean, storytelling really is one person guiding another person through something. This is not that. This is more about nonfiction, about reading, about delving into something and then seeing the connections and then drifting off. It does feel a little bit digressive.
Consider history, okay? Mm-hmm. History is not linear. Rather, no. It is a cataract of simultaneous events in different places involving different people that interact in many different ways.
Right.
Parallel pages visibly connected, I believe, is a far better way of organizing the presentation of history.
Absolutely. In fact, what we've made history, story is key. We've taken what happened and we've reductionist made stories out of it because we can understand that easily. If we understood the cataract, if we could appreciate the cataract, hey, yeah, but I think it sometimes could be overwhelming, couldn't it?
Well, of course.
I'm not as smart as you, Ted. So
knowledge in any field is overwhelming. The point is for the recipient to be able to adjust the flow rate, and for the donor to be able to present it in its full glory.
And in a way, I think that we are getting a little bit more that modern. Some people complain about it, but that modern technologies, things like Twitter and so forth, are getting us more and more used to the idea that there are many different things going on at once, and that we can. I think what happened with me, for instance, with Twitter, is I felt like I need to appreciate the full thing in its entirety, and I suddenly realized I didn't have to. I could dip in and out. I could move fluidly through it. Is that a skill that would be useful in Xanadu?
Just a second.
Are we losing our... Your connection, by the way, is superb. I don't know how, but somehow this houseboat has the best internet of anybody we've ever talked to.
I'm very surprised. some things work better than others, that's all I can say.
It's working well for us.
Okay, good.
I'm looking at Xanadu, and I have to say that I...
By the way, when you say Xanadu... We give a different name to every instantiation. This one is called Open Xanadu.
Open Xanadu. Okay.
This one works in the browser. The very same document you're looking at, there's a demo on YouTube called Xanadu Space, and it looks entirely different, but it's presenting the same connections.
Okay.
So here, for example, you see the little green beam from one paragraph to its origin. So you can walk across that bridge and see the same piece in both contexts.
Right.
Try doing that in PDF.
You're too smart, Ted. I think that you have to allow for us dummies to catch up with you. I think that's part of the problem. Do you feel that way sometimes, that you're misunderstood because we don't understand?
I've always felt that way.
Yeah.
But the point is that to me, human understanding is vital, and that's what I want to promote, although I'm not necessarily very good at doing it in person because of my impatience.
Well, it's, you know, you mentioned Doug Engelbart and Steve Jobs. There are two people who also had visions, who were impatient.
Yes.
One, Steve Jobs, was able to kind of muscle his visions through.
Yep.
The other, Doug, was, I think, always too sweet. Some of his visions became true, but
well,
not all.
Yeah, the rug pulled out from him, under him after the great demo. So,
yeah.
As I said in my... I had a tribute to him where I pointed out that he was dumped by ARPA, he was dumped by the Stanford Research Institute, he was snubbed by Xerox PARC, and he was a wandering soul for the remaining 30, 40 working years. But he was the founder of it all, and he understood. I didn't hear about him until I'd been working in the field for 5 years.
Yeah, I'm wondering, so you had you met him?
No, I heard about him after my first major talk in 1965. Bob Taylor came up to me and said, "Have I heard of Douglas Engelbart?" I said, "No." But I went to him. I went and visited him a year later at SRI in 66. He showed me the mouse, and I said, "Oh, great, that's better than light bends." And so I was immediately converted to the mouse, and I now finally have a cord keyboard. It's really puzzling to me that no one makes them. Nobody makes them available. I haven't learned it yet, and somebody putting a USB interface on it so I can use it.
Seems like the 60s were an incredibly creative decade, and at the same time as some of this creativity was in music and in culture, that there were technologists like you and Engelbart who are doing the same kind of thing in technology.
I'm not a technologist. I call myself a systems humanist. Because it is human goals I seek for which I find technical means.
Yeah.
Other systems humanists I worship are Leonardo da Vinci and Buckminster Fuller.
Oh, Bucky. Brilliant.
And Frank Lloyd Wright. Yep. That was my boyhood hero.
Yeah. I saw Bucky speak in his later years, and I've never been more inspired.
Me too. Yep. Went on for 4 hours, I believe, and I don't think I even took a bathroom break. Right?
Yeah. Another person like you, like Doug, there are a handful of people like Alan Kay who somehow are thinking about this thing at a whole another level. And
well, it's multiple contexts.
That's the ability to synthesize disparate fields to make something much more powerful. I guess, yeah. I think you're right. So, I see a quote, and you'll have to correct me because it's from Wikipedia, that says that Tim Berners-Lee invented in HTML was exactly what we were trying to avoid with Project Xanadu.
Yep, because it was just jump links and with tainted content. The content is polluted by all that markup inside it, so you can't reuse it.
That's true, isn't it?
Yeah. So the point is that Xanadu uses clean content and puts the links outside the content. And that's been done more successfully up till now by a system called Microcosm that was based on Xanadu, done in England. So you can have the links separate.
There's also the flaw that the links expire, they age. We now have a web full of broken links.
That's a huge issue, and the question is, how do you maintain it? Yeah, that's always been a problem.
What is your proposal there?
Well, in our in Xanadu, the links don't break in the sense that if a document changes, the links are still to whatever parts remain that they were originally to. So if you have a link to a certain sentence in a certain paragraph of a Xanadoc, and then that paragraph is moved and something is inserted in the middle of that sentence, nevertheless, the link will still connect to the front part of the sentence and the back part of the sentence, so you'll be able to read it in the same way. But you'll also be able to move forward and backward in time, and that we call that hypertime, and that design is on the web. It's perfectly straightforward. That was implemented separately in Japan, but we haven't put all the parts together.
We're talking with Ted Nelson, the first person to coin the word hypertext and hypermedia back in the early 60s. He says, "I'm not a computer scientist, I'm a humanist." We'll talk more.
Systems humanist.
A systems humanist. I like that. What does that mean?
Well, it means that a humanist may just scribble in books and be scholars. But a systems humanist tries to set up systems that make things better for people, like Bucky Fuller, like Frank Lloyd Wright, and like Leonardo da Vinci.
And much like those guys, often misunderstood. In fact, if this were the Middle Ages, they would have burnt you at the stake as a witch.
I'm not sure of that. They certainly didn't burn Leonardo.
No, they didn't.
He was a pal of the kings.
He was very, he was political. He was thinking how not to get burnt.
it wasn't an issue. There wasn't a lot of the burning at the stake had to do with the Catholic Protestantism, and that was... didn't affect his
he stayed out of religion. Smart man.
Yeah.
Be nice to the Pope, he'll be nice to you. So hypertext and hypermedia, you have there, I'm looking at a list of words created by Ted Nelson. I like intertwingularity. What is intertwingling?
Well, it's a self-instantiating word. I mean, it combines intertwined and intermingled into one word. It's a portmanteau, and it's an example of itself.
Intertwingled is intertwingled.
Exactly.
There's a playfulness to what you do, too, that I love, that I just really enjoy, that I think some people miss.
Words should be fun.
Yeah.
And language is fluid. Language is changeable, and you too can change it. I think I've gotten more words in the dictionary than Lewis Carroll.
he also loved playing with words.
Right. Yeah. Dildonics was one that finally caught on.
Teledildonics did in fact have a life of its own. This was
somebody added the tele. That wasn't mine.
But dildonics was yours. Okay. Actually, the tele is implied by the dildonics, and we might just leave it at that.
just as hypertext does not imply data communication, but kind of expects it.
Actually, there is a company that makes a vibrator called the Vibes that can be controlled over the internet now.
Yeah, I believe there are a lot of them now. And ranging with a very wide price range, nothing is caught on. But I mean, you could take an ordinary Microsoft flight control stick, which I think has a vibration thing in it, and just put another sleeve on it.
Put that on the internet.
Yeah. but that's I/O. You know, that's hardware.
It's literally input output.
Getting into hardware is really
all gone. On Wikipedia, and they need a citation, so we're going to give them a citation. They quote you as saying, a user interface should be so simple that a beginner in an emergency can understand it within 10 seconds. Did you say that?
I said it, and now in today's world, I'm not so sure, but my example was a fire extinguisher. Once upon a time. And I coined it before, in fact, before my fire extinguisher experience. But my fire extinguisher experience was as follows. I'm in the kitchen cooking something, and something catches fire in my pan and maybe spread a little. And there was a fire extinguisher nearby. Now, I'd never used a fire extinguisher. I never studied a fire extinguisher. But it had a handle and a lever with the handle, and it had a pin which was obviously holding the handle in place. There was only one choice.
To pull the pin.
I pressed the handle and
it worked.
Now that to me is wonderful design.
That's good UI.
That's good UI. And the whole point is that that now that we have so many choices, the dumb thing, the hard part is to make some choices easy and obvious. And it's kind of tucked the other ones away. And where Steve Jobs' genius was in understanding the user and how it would look and feel to the user. I believe Jobs was a psychopath. He was a vicious, nasty man who truly understood the hearts and minds of the user with no sympathy for them, but a great deal of empathy, so that that he was able to design and he's been called a marketer, which is a complete misunderstanding. He was a designer. He was a movie director. I believe software is a branch of movie making. What is a movie? Events on the screen that affect the heart and mind of the viewer. What is software? Events on the screen that affect the heart and mind of the user and interact and have consequences. So which is it more important to study? Movie making or programming? Answer, both. But the programming is a part of the movie making.
I love that. You need the technology. You need the tools to express.
You need a camera to make a movie.
Right. And so your goal all along has been just to understand tools and make better tools for people who want to tell stories or...
You could say, or not so much tools as tapestries. I don't think... The tool is the editor and the viewer, but to me, it's the tapestry of the literature is the real objective. So think of the tapestry of conventional literature as being books on shelves which can be pulled out. And by the way, books are compatible. You can put two of them on the same table. And you can't do that with Kindle and with Microsoft Word. Point.
You actually applied for a patent very early on in the early 60s for a video for tech using a computer to edit video.
Yep. Well, not only that, I applied for a patent in 1971 for computer realistic photorealistic movie making. This was a side issue. Not being a mathematician, I couldn't approach it from the way the other guys did it, the people at Pixar who did it later, or who were doing it at the same time, excuse me. They took the mathematical approach, and I took a spatial approach and said, what are the spatial structures to be recognized and explored? And that patent application I just published, it's called The Scene Machine.
Neat.
You can get it at lulu.com for $30. It's a 270-page patent application.
I love it. Was the patent approved?
No. Well, I realized when I finished it,
it was too specific.
As I was finishing, I realized that I couldn't afford to get it.
Yeah.
And because the prosecution of a patent through the labyrinths of the patent office is a very expensive and difficult process. However, for the sake of finishing it, I finished it and filed the application. And people who are interested in the history of these things can read it. Nobody else took my same approach for, I think, 20 years. My approach was to build an object of triangles and not try to precisely determine the curvature across them. Just change the size of the triangles and let that take care of the shape of the object. And that's now one of the fundamental techniques.
It is. That's right.
Yep.
Do you think user interfaces on most technology today fails? It certainly is not something a beginner in an emergency could understand within seconds.
Most technical people have virtually no idea how to present things to you.
They really don't.
So the problem is that the people who understand it don't have the control.
Right.
And that was where Steve Jobs came in. Steve Jobs understood it, and he could slap wrists or cut throats and make it work the way he wanted it to work top down. And other people with the taste don't have the authority in general. So the interfaces are guaranteed to get worse and worse.
Yeah. The people designing the software understand how it works, so they don't. They never have the beginner's mind.
Yep. The other part is that software cannot, as a rule, be rebuilt. That's called refactoring, and it's something like moving the pyramids of Giza. because software cannot change underneath, all you can do is add to it. And so while the thing may have had a clean interface at the beginning, they keep adding stuff. So on Gmail now, all this crap pops up in all directions. I have no idea. If you accidentally hit something with the mouse, you don't know what you've just triggered. And that's how it is everywhere, because they keep adding new things you can accidentally trigger with no sense of unity and no control of the overall effect.
See, I think the Hindus understood it, that destruction is a key component of creation.
Well, destruction isn't the word. Coalescence and unification is the issue.
Yeah.
So, but it's very hard to do the top-down unification that needs to be done when you're dealing with disparate pieces.
Right.
So, software is a doomed art.
I love from your YouTube video on zigzag data structures, we should not impose regularity where it does not exist. It does seem a human tendency to want to regularize things, to impose a structure on something that has no structure, for instance.
Right. That was what Aristotle did. Everything became a hierarchy.
Right.
My Greek philosopher is named Heraclitus. He's the guy who said you can't step in the same river twice, that the world is a blooming, buzzing, intertwined morass of fast-changing things in every direction.
I love
that. That's what we want to represent.
We visited Ephesus, his home, a couple of months ago, and it's just wonderful to think that Heraclitus walked these paths.
For heaven's sake!
Yeah, it's beautiful. It's quite well preserved. It's kind of remarkable.
In other words, it wasn't in the middle of things.
Yes, right. Was off the beaten path. Nobody, it wasn't strategically important. You were a philosophy major in college. It sounds like philosophy has very much influenced you.
Well, philosophy is everywhere.
Yeah.
Everything, there are possible generalizations about everything, and that's what philosophy is. And I was very amused. You know, there was this orgy club in the 1960s called Plato's Retreat.
Yes.
And I wonder why the heck they gave it the name. And it turned out that somewhere, maybe it's on Wikipedia, the founder said, because philosophy is so hard, he wanted to give a place to philosophers where there wouldn't be any philosophy. Well, if there's one place where there's
just a lot of fooling around. I don't think Plato would have enjoyed Plato's Retreat, I'll be honest with you.
Well, I didn't know him.
I didn't either, so I'm just projecting. Transclusion.
Yeah.
What's that?
I coined the word, and it's one of those things, words which is coined on, but it turns out that my transclusion is different from everybody else's. For example, Wikipedia is based on transclusion. It means inclusion of content across a document boundary. So a quotation is a transclusion, but it's not live because you can't go to the original source.
Right.
So in Xanadu transclusion, you can see the original source and the current usage side by side.
I actually love that idea.
Yeah, well, it's right, and that's working now. That you can see at Xanadu.com.
Yeah. I think that appeals to a certain mind, a mind that is willing to travel down tributaries and then come back to the main river and move around. But I think unfortunately, maybe we are taught not to do that, but I think that's kind of the natural mind but we feel like, well, there's not enough time to do that. Let me focus on what I'm up to.
Yeah.
But that's how we learn.
The honest thing I've discovered is that the people who relate most to Xanadu tend to be women.
Interesting.
I was surprised, but over the last 5 years, the men I show it to shrug and say, well, you could do it another way technically. And the women say, my God, that means this. Now you can see this, now you can see that. So that's it's a very interesting, maybe left brain, right brain, who knows. the whole point is to be able to understand more and to see more.
Is the Xanadu space you demonstrate on YouTube, is this closer to your vision of what Xanadu should be?
The visualization, there are many different visualizations. Oh, there you are. Yes, yeah. Thank you. There are many visualizations, but the structure is the same. So the point is, if you understand the structure,
got it.
The visualization is not that important.
That's kind of irrelevant how it's presented, as long as you can do it.
But the one in Xanadu space is extremely nice, whereas Open Xanadu is a little more stark and jumpy. But in this case, you can see in the Xanadu space one that you're showing now, you can see the different pages swarf up to be next to whatever they're connected to.
Yeah. It does seem like the natural way we would like to investigate ideas and learn.
Yeah.
Sure, a lot more interesting than just reading a long book with footnotes.
Well, not only that, but when I read a book, for example, the example I use is a book I have on the occupation of France by the Nazis. And there's a chapter on politics and a chapter on the movie industry and a chapter on culture and a chapter on agriculture. And so, but they were all happening at the same time.
Right.
Yet they've been broken. These parallel events have been broken into a sequence because the book cannot present them in a parallel fashion that shows their interconnection.
I've seen timelines done that show how everything happened at once. Yeah. And sometimes it's an eye-opener. You mean that was going on here when that was going on there? And
here's a nice book called Ribbons of Time that does that.
Yeah.
And there was something I had when I was a boy called the Histo Map, done by someone named Sparks in the 1930s. And it was about 5 feet long and hung on the wall, and it was... It showed what was happening in Europe and Asia and the Americas, etc., for the last 5,000 years.
Wow!
Yeah, so it gives you an overview in parallel. So parallel overview that to me is the great grail.
Do you think that influenced your thinking?
Of course.
Yeah, you grew up looking at that map.
Yeah.
We're talking with Ted Nelson, the pioneer in, I'm not going to say in computing, I'm going to say a pioneer in media.
Thank you.
And I stand corrected, because you really are. But on how our modern technology can be used to change how we distribute, understand, use, create media.
We'll have more with Ted Nelson on Triangulation in just a little bit. But if I might, I'd like to interrupt and talk about a personal capital. A company started by one of our Triangulation guests. Bill Harris is a former CEO of Intuit, of PayPal, knows a lot about financial stuff. We talked to him a couple of years ago, and he was just getting started with something new called personal capital. And I have to say, I signed up right away, and I am glad I did. Personal capital is all about knowing where your money is, what it's doing to prepare for your future. I think that's a good description of it. If you visit personalcapital.com, you'll see that over 500,000 people are now using personal capital to manage $100 billion in finances. They've got great software. You enter in your accounts so it can keep track of them and all. It'll give you a live dashboard that'll tell you exactly where you stand. They've got a team of objective certified financial planners that'll help you understand where your money's going, help you rebalance your assets. It is very efficient. It is very effective. And by the way, it's absolutely free to use their apps, to use their website. Know how much you're overpaying in fees, how to reduce those fees, how to get better advice to optimize your investment. Plan for your future with Personal Capital. It's on Amazon's Kindle. It's on Google Play. It's on the App Store. It is a really great idea designed to help you. We harvest tax losses, capture profits, and rebalance your portfolio automatically with personal finance. The software is free, and it lets you get your entire financial life in one place. I'm a big fan. I've been using it, and I have to say, it's really helped me put my money to work more efficiently. That's what it's all about, isn't it? You're putting money aside for your retirement. Make sure it's doing the work it ought to do. Make sure you don't leave money on the table. personalcapital.com/triangulation. It's free, and it's smart. personalcapital.com/triangulation.
So, Ted, you've been doing this for a long time. What's ahead? What is undone that you'd like to do?
Well, as I said, I've lost many years, wasted time.
50 years since you coined the term hypertext.
Yep. And I think 48 since I published it. 49. And the point is, I have many projects that I wanted to use this for. Now I'm 77 years old. How long am I going to last? I don't know. But and what's even scarier is that the days and weeks go so much faster than they used to. Nobody warned me about that. And so all the projects that I have notes for, who knows when I'll be able to finish. So my original plan in 1960 was, I figured there's going to be a personal computer field. I'm going to found it. There's going to be worldwide hypertext. I'm going to found that. And that'll make me so rich that I can have all my notes transferred, put in the computer, and I can use my own tools for writing these, for creating these movies, writing these books, and so on, or these hypertexts. Didn't work out that way. I didn't have the money. And so I've got hundreds of thousands of notes on many subjects, which may never be gathered together, but some scholars might be interested in them. On the other hand, I could live a long time. Frank Lloyd Wright worked till 92. Bucky, I think, worked till 88. So that's my hope, that I can keep on going at full tilt.
It's exciting. And I hope you do, because I love your ideas. We can all go to hyperland.com to find out more. I want to get your book, because it's
Which
a classic. Computer okay. Lib.
I also recommend I don't have a copy here, my autobiography, Possiplex, which has a lot of interesting anecdotes along the way.
Good. I shall.
My favorite, I think, in this context is when I met Isaac Asimov at a party in 1961. And I said, "Mr. Asimov, soon we'll be reading and writing on computer screen." And the great futurist said sarcastically, "Yeah, sure."
That's great. Do you read science fiction?
Did. I don't read fiction anymore. I don't have time.
No time.
I have very few leisure pursuits and very little social life.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
At the screen most of the time, yeah.
I think as you get older, things become more urgent, don't they?
Yeah. Well, things always seemed urgent to me, but...
Yeah.
No, it's much, much more so.
Such a pleasure to spend some time with you, Ted. I thank you so much.
Well, terrific.
And congratulations on at least some implementations of Xanadu, making it out so that people get a better idea of what you're thinking. And I hope you continue to do this work.
Thank you very much.
I appreciate
I've enjoyed this talk very much.
Thank you. Ted Nelson, hyperland.com or Xanadu.com.
Both.
Both. It's too bad that stupid Olivia Newton-John movie came out, because that really obscures the Google results. Fortunately, it's receding in the past.
Well, people don't know that Xanadu is a real place. It was.
Oh, yeah, where Kublai Khan, his stately pleasure dome, decreed.
You can actually see it from Google Earth as a rectangle about 300 kilometers north of Beijing.
You can. I didn't know that. I did not know that.
Yep.
So it's not mythical, it's not imaginary, and there is, in fact, a structure remaining.
Supported by Marco Polo, who went there.
That's right.
Yep.
That's right.
And so, and Coleridge wrote about it as he was reading in an opiate trance, as he was reading Marco Polo's travels, or some report of them. And so it all came to him in a dream, the poem that is so challenging.
Wow.
So that seemed to, the fact that that Coleridge claimed to forget most of the poem because he was interrupted by the notorious person from Porlock, that was the part of the inspiration for using that name, because I wanted Xanadu to be the magic place of literary memory where nothing is forgotten.
Wonderful, I love that. Now, I don't suppose you have time to tweet. Do you tweet or?
I don't really get it. It seems such a cascade of garbage.
That's pretty much accurate.
But I am tweeting. Yes, I have various one-liners to get off my chest. So every couple of days, I send out another one.
What's your Twitter handle?
The Ted Nelson.
The Ted Nelson. I'm going to follow you, because every once in a while, a little pithy epigram from Ted Nelson would be, I think, anodyne. So let me follow you right now.
All right.
Possibility versus reality, the eternal game of everything. Paranoids are always the first to know. Life and death are both hereditary. Carpe diem, seize the god. I love it. How did the Ted Nelson Day at Chapman go?
It was wonderful.
Was it fun?
Many surprises. Alan Kay didn't show up, and his video didn't play.
Oh.
But instead Wozniak showed up and
wasn't on the schedule
and talked all about how my influence on him. So that was nice.
That's incredible, in fact, because Woz is very busy. For him to show up ever is huge.
Yeah.
I've known Woz for some time, and I think the world of him, and it's hard for me to get any time with him because he's just so darn busy these days.
Yep.
So that's pretty cool that he showed up. And I think the world of Alan Kay. I would love to try to get Alan Kay on this show. I think he's fascinating.
He's also evasive. Yeah.
Yeah.
But extremely witty and quotable.
Quotable. Very good. Yeah. Hey, thank you, Ted. Thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it.
All right.
Enjoy the rest of your afternoon. Take care.